knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Let's move on to second-order PDEs, starting with a famous equation called Laplace's equation. Laplace's equation is a second-order linear elliptic PDE, given by uxx plus uyy equals 0. This is how we would write Laplace's equations in the 2D Cartesian coordinates x and y. In general, these equations are usually written in terms of the Laplacian operator, symbolized with a triangle squared, which is an operator from vector calculus defined as the divergence of the gradient. Recall that the divergence of a vector field tells us how much the field tends to push flow outwards overall, whereas the gradient of a scalar field tells us a vector in the direction of steepest ascent on the surface represented by the scalar field. So we can think of the Laplacian as indicating by how much the values surrounding a point differ from the point. So a positive Laplacian indicates a local minimum, while a negative Laplacian indicates a local maximum, although it is important to remember that these conditions are not sufficient to characterize stationary points, as we may recall from multivariable calculus via the Hessian matrix, whose trace is the Laplacian. The Laplacian operator looks quite different in other coordinate systems, like 3D cylindrical or spherical coordinates. Laplace's equation then becomes the Laplacian operator of u equal to 0. So in the language of vector calculus, the solutions to Laplace's equation are the functions whose gradient fields are solenoidal vector fields. Let's see how we can go about finding these solutions. Separation of variables is the most straightforward technique for solving linear PDEs, and our first step is to make the assumption that the solutions to our PDE can be written as a product of functions of each individual variable. To solve the Laplace equation, we let u of xy equal capital X of x times capital Y of y, where capital X and capital Y are single variable functions. When we substitute this into our PDE, uxx plus uyy equals 0, the partial derivatives become ordinary derivatives of our functions x and y. We can divide both sides by the product of our functions xy and move one term to the other side. We get x double prime of x divided by x of x equals negative y double prime of y divided by y of y. We have now separated the variables, because each side of this equation only depends on a single different variable. Since the left side is a function of only x, and the right side is a function of only y, the only way for these statements to be true at the same time is if both sides are actually just the constant function, and we call this constant the separation constant, conventionally using the symbol plus or minus lambda squared, where we can choose whichever sign makes the subsequent algebra easier. This time, we'll stick with the positive lambda squared and see where it takes us. We can then set each side equal to this lambda squared constant, and we will get two different second-order ODEs, one for x and one for y. We have had lots of practice solving these equations, and hopefully it's obvious that the solution for our x equation will be exponential functions of lambda x, while the solution for our y equation will be sines and cosines of lambda y. In the context of PDEs, these types of differential equations, where one of the coefficients is the separation constant lambda, are called sturm-liouville problems. Also, in the context of PDEs, while we can write our exponential functions in the form we're familiar with, we often prefer to write them in terms of the hyperbolic functions, cosh and sine, recalling that cosh of x is the same as half of e to the x plus e to the minus x, and sine of x is the same as half of e to the x minus e to the minus x. These functions span the same fundamental solutions as the exponential functions. The reason we prefer using the hyperbolic functions at this stage is that there are some complex number identities that we can exploit to better visualize our solutions. From Euler's identity, we can show that cosh of ix equals cosine of x, and sine of ix equals I sine of x. What this means is that when we use a different sign of the separation constant lambda to solve the ODEs, we are effectively switching out trig functions for hyperbolic functions and vice versa. We should also mention that it is possible to choose lambda equals zero as the separation constant, and this will give us solutions for x and y that are linear functions in x and y, but again, we should only do this if the boundary conditions make it possible for this to be a solution in the first place. Let's see an example of what we mean by this. Suppose that we want to find a function u of xy that satisfies the Laplace equation on the domain x greater than 0 and y between minus l over 2 and l over 2. We have a boundary condition that the limit as x approaches infinity of u must go to 0, and also that the value of u on the boundary of our domain is 0. We can use the first condition to know that our function of x must be exponential, because that's the only way to get it to decay to zero, as trig functions don't decay, and so we will choose the positive separation constant, lambda squared. A good starting solution is then the exponential or equivalently hyperbolic functions in x and the trig functions in y, and we can choose the constant a equals 0 to ensure that only the negative exponential remains, so that our first boundary condition is satisfied. Next, the second condition gives some clues on how our function of y behaves. It is a trig function that has to be zero at two symmetric places, which means two things. First, that the period of this sinusoidal function can only take certain discrete values, corresponding to a cosine wave that passes through these points. And second, that it must be an even function. Given that y must be even, we can rule out the sine term right away, since sine is an odd function, while cosine is an even function. We can therefore set d equal to 0 in our solution. To find the allowable periods of our cosine wave, we can see that if the period of our wave is 2l, then this will satisfy the boundary condition of being 0 at plus or minus l over 2. However, we can also notice that any odd integer multiple of this fundamental frequency will also satisfy the same condition, so we can consider dividing this period of 2l by an odd integer, 2n plus 1. By subbing this into our general solution, we can see that the allowable values of our separation constant lambda are given by 2n plus 1 times pi over l. Each of these values of lambda gives a different solution, all of which form an independent basis of solutions, and all will satisfy this boundary condition. We now take a linear superposition over all of our basis solutions, which will be an infinite summation over all the allowable values of n, and this is our solution. We would actually need one more boundary condition to find the values of the last constants, Cn prime, telling us that the problem we were given was not well posed. If we add the Dirichlet initial condition u of 0 y equals 5 cosine pi y over l, we can make it well posed and finish this off. Subbing in x equals 0 tells us that only one of our basis functions now has the correct frequency, and that will be the fundamental solution of n equals 0, and we also get c0 equals 5 for this frequency. Our final solution that satisfies all three of our conditions is then u of xy equals 5e to the minus pi x over l times cosine of pi y over l. If we plot this function out, notice how when we view the surface from the perspective of each axis, the resulting plots correspond precisely to the familiar forms of our functions x and y. Now we should very briefly mention some variants of Laplace's equation. If we take Laplace's equation and include a coefficient of u term, we get the Helmholtz equation, whereas if we take Laplace's equation and make it non-homogeneous with a general function f of xy on the right side, we get Poisson's equation. The Helmholtz PDE can be solved using the same separation of variables approach, although the resulting sturm-liouville problems can require special functions to solve, and Poisson's equation can be solved similarly, this time requiring a particular integral to add to the complementary solution. Like Laplace's equation, these three elliptic PDEs turn up when modeling various physical phenomena, usually relating to describing a steady state that doesn't depend on time, such as heat transfer at equilibrium or diffraction of electromagnetic waves. We'll get more into applications like those in the coming tutorials, but for now, that's an overview of solving Laplace's equation by the separation of variables method. As you can see, most of the effort in solving PDEs by this method is not actually in solving the differential equation itself, but rather fitting the boundary conditions to constrain the general solution as much as possible. We'll later see some different approaches, but for now, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.